So let's talk about those properties that do make up those 700 different types of soil and that are important for gardening. We break those properties down into three categories: physical properties, chemical properties, and biological properties. Physical properties include the soil structure, the texture of the soil, and the amount of air and water, the pore spaces in the soil. Chemical properties are things that we usually associate with soil tests, the pH, the amount of organic matter in the soil, and the plant available nutrients. And biological properties are really important, like we stressed in that introduction. The biology is an often overlooked but really important part of the soil. And we're talking about the microscopic, the microbial organisms, but also the larger animals that do live in the soil. So let's start with physical properties. Soil texture. When somebody uses the term soil texture, they're just talking about the relative amounts of sand, silt, and clay in a soil. And here we see a representation of the relative sizes of sand to silt to clay. Chemically, these particles are often very similar in their chemical composition. So sand and silt might have a very similar makeup. The main difference is the difference in the particle size. You can see that sand is several times larger than the silt particle, which in turn is several times larger than the tiny blue speck there representing clay. So we use the soil textural triangle here to determine or to identify the soil texture by name. This has always been a little bit of a challenging graphic to explain because you have three variables. So we have the percent clay here on the left side, percent silt on the right, and the percent sand. So you basically only need to know two of these parameters to give your soil a name. Let's say we have a soil that has 30% clay and 50% sand. So the arrow here is pointing horizontal for clay, which means when we see these two, we look at the 30 here on the clay, it has two lines going to it. But we want to follow the horizontal one. So we follow this 30% number clay until we run into the diagonal line coming off of percent sand that's moving up to the left. And see this arrow is pointing here? It means we followed our finger up that line, not up that one. So 50% sand and 30% clay corresponds with 20% silt. And that means we have a sandy clay loam. Sandy clay loam. So you can do that with any amount of soil texture. Down here in Dane County, we have a lot of silty loams or silt loam soils, which tend to have maybe 10, 15% clay, 10, 15% sand, and 70 to 80% silt. One way to estimate the texture of a soil is to use a jar test, where you take a mason jar, a bell jar, fill it with, you can see about how much soil, and then we add 2 tablespoons of Calgon, which is a bath salt, which contains a chemical which disperses the clay. And then you fill up the jar most of the way with water and vigorously shake it several times. Shake it, let it sit, shake it, let it sit, shake it, let it sit. And then when you're done, just let it sit for a day or two. And after that day or two, the water will clear up again. And you'll come back and you'll see something that looks something like this, where we have the sand sitting at the bottom because those larger particles settle out first. And then we have a layer of silt, which is our medium-sized particles. And finally, at the very top will be this very fine layer of clay. And simply by estimating the thickness of those three layers, you can get a pretty good estimation of the amount of sand, silt, and clay in your soil. And you can go back to that soil textural triangle and get a generalization of the soil texture of that sample. So soil particles don't exist as individual particles in the soil. They actually group together to form aggregates. So a soil aggregate is a collection of the sand, silt, and clay particles and how they hold together. the size and the way that those aggregates fit together is what we call a soil structure. And soil structure is really, really important. I think it's more important than the texture of the soil. The texture gives us the particle size, but really the structure and how those particles fit together determines a lot of things, like the amount of water that that soil is able to store, the way the water moves through the soil, the way the roots can penetrate, and the way that oxygen moves up and down into the soil. It also determines the resistance to erosion from wind and water, and how susceptible it is to compaction and crusting. The topsoil, we like to have a crumbly or a granular structure. Platy soil structure is just like it sounds, that the soil particles stick together in these thin plates, which you can imagine impede root movement and impede downward flow. So that's an undesirable soil structure. Down deeper in the soil, we often find blocky or prismatic or columnar structure, which influences the soil properties as well. Compaction is something that can ruin soil structure. So we have these soil particles that stick together. And if you crush that soil and compact it down, you can change that soil structure for the worse. And soil structure takes a very long time to develop, but can be harmed very, very quickly. So speaking of compaction, we talked earlier about how the ideal composition of soil would be 25% airspace, 25% soil water, and 50% solids. And that's represented in the diagram in the upper left. But if you compact the soil, essentially what you're doing is you're squeezing out the pore space, and you're left with a higher percentage of mineral matter and a smaller amount of air and water space. So that makes the soil heavier, and it also closes off those pore spaces that are so important for plant growth. On the bottom is a different representation of that. You can see a non-compacted soil has a lot of air spaces, water surrounding the soil particles. When we compact that soil, we squeeze out those air spaces, and in this picture, it shows as a consequence there's more water held there. Often compacted soils are associated with being wet, and that shows the physical reason behind that. One thing we don't really think about is the importance of oxygen to plants. And we often talk about plants and their ability to assimilate carbon dioxide, make it into a sugar, and use that as its food source while giving off oxygen. But that's really what leaves do. And what roots do, which are also a part of the plant, is similar to what animals do with oxygen. That is, they require oxygen to function, and they give off carbon dioxide. So plant roots are doing what you and I are doing. We're breathing in oxygen, giving off CO2, and that's exactly what a plant root is doing. So a soil not only has to behave as a support media for the plant and a nutrient supply storehouse, but it also has to facilitate the movement of oxygen into the soil so the roots can get it, and the movement of the carbon dioxide out. It needs to be a fine-tuned ventilation system. And when we ruin that structure, we compact that soil, we limit the ability of oxygen to diffuse in and carbon dioxide to diffuse out, which decreases the growing potential of that type of environment. On the bottom right-hand corner, you see a picture here that's gray with these little red streaks in it. And this essentially iron reduction and oxidation. When you have oxygen near iron, soil often contains high amounts of iron. When there's oxygen present with iron, you get this orange color. On our cars, we know that as rust. In the soil, it's a good thing. On our cars, not so much. And so the soil in the big picture, very red. We can assume that this is a well-ventilated soil. The soil on the right with this gray color with only tiny specks of red, we can conclude that that soil aeration is a major problem in that soil. Water holding capacity is another important physical property of a soil. And we can often estimate the water holding capacity of a soil by understanding its textural class. So in the soil textural triangle, we looked at a silty clay loam, we looked at silt loam. So all these different names are representations on that soil textural triangle. And so if we look on this table, the sandy loam, we scroll over, we see that it has anywhere from 1.25 to 1.4 inches of available water per foot of root zone depth. So if we have a 1 foot root zone, we can estimate that we will have about an inch and a third of water available to the plant. If the roots go down 2 feet, we can double that. So it's an estimation of how much water will be available. So you can make some estimations on how often irrigation would be required, if at all. Look at the coarse sand. Very, very low available water holding capacity. And also clay. Clay has a very low water holding capacity. We find the greatest water holding capacity in the silt loam category, which is a reason why the Midwest is rich in silt, and obviously part of the reason why we've been so successful in our agricultural endeavors. pH is a chemical property. We've discussed the physical properties, now we're moving on to the chemical properties. So pH has a huge effect on the ability of plants to grow. Some plants prefer low pH, other plants thrive in high pH situations, and many plants prefer a neutral pH. So understanding the soil pH helps you put the right plant in the right place. Soil pH affects the availability of nutrients. Some nutrients, like iron, are much more available at low pHs, as you can see in this figure. Other nutrients like phosphorus are most available at the neutral pH, while other nutrients like calcium and magnesium become less and less available at low pH. So you can see why the majority of plants prefer a relatively neutral pH, is because that's the section of this graphic where most of the nutrients are at their maximum availability. If we get too far to one end or the other, some of these nutrients taper off pretty quickly. But again, each plant has a specific pH range where its growth is maximized. Let's talk about some of these pH optima for turf and garden plants. Turf grasses, we're starting out here, and this is my specialty, Kentucky bluegrass and creeping red fescue. You can see the pH ranges there. I will say that in my experience, turf grasses tend to be one of the more tolerant species to wide ranges in pH. So Kentucky bluegrass tends to do well in a wide range of pH. Maybe around pH 5, you'd start to see a decrease, 5.5. But definitely, I've seen outstanding Kentucky bluegrass grown at a pH of 8.2 or 8.4. Creeping red fescue is more tolerant of acidic conditions than Kentucky bluegrass. But again, it's also very tolerant of a wide range. You can see for sweet corn, we have an optimum pH of 6. Potato prefers slightly more acidic soils. Blueberry is very famous for preferring highly acidic soils with a pH of 4.2. But understanding the pH for the crop that you're trying to grow is really important. Okay, soil organic matter, another chemical property of soils. Soil organic matter is the living, dead, the decay products of plants, animals, and microorganisms in the soil. And it gives the soil that characteristic brown and sometimes black color. So this soil that we're looking at here in the picture is a mollisol. It's a soil associated with prairie plants. You can see it have a deep, thick organic layer down to 2 feet. You can see the original color of the soil material is a much lighter brown or gray color, and that organic matter imparts that darkness to it. Most soils contain about 2 to 4% organic matter, but that number can vary depending on the location in the landscape and the previous management. So it makes up a small percentage of the soil, but it's a very, very important property in terms of the quality of that soil for gardening. And the reason for that is that organic matter, along with clay, is the main nutrient storehouse, if you will, in the soil. Clay and organic matter have a natural negative charge, which means that they attract and hold on to positively charged ions. So nutrients like calcium, magnesium, potassium, and ammonium have a positive charge. So just like a magnet, those nutrients will be attracted to and stored on clay and organic matter particles and held for eventual uptake by plants. So they're easily displaced, they're not permanently fixed, which means that plants can use them. As you can imagine, if we have a net negative charge in our soil, when we add negatively charged ions like nitrate or chloride or sulfate, those ions will have the ability to leach through the soil. They can move very rapidly because the soil is not retaining them with that electric charge. The reason we talk about nitrate pollution in groundwater is because nitrate will move through the soil profile very rapidly because of the negative charge on that nitrate ion. So here we're looking at a visual representation of what cation exchange capacity is. So this is the cation exchange capacity is a term that we use as soil scientists to describe the amount of negative charges in a soil. I have a soil particle here, and you can imagine these different sites with a negative charge, and associated with each of those negative charges is a positively charged ion or nutrient. So if we don't have an adequate supply of nutrients, we end up with deficiency symptoms, or another way to think about that is an illness or a sickness of the plant. In the pictures here, we're looking at corn. The one with the black background shows what a nitrogen deficiency looks like. The leaves start to turn yellow and then eventually black after a prolonged period of time. In the right-hand picture, we're looking at a phosphorus deficiency. Phosphorus is unique because it often produces a purple coloration and a stunted plant. Very, very unique symptom. So if this is something that you want to diagnose, if you're having a problem with a plant and it has a purple stunted look to it, one option might be a phosphorus deficiency. In turf grass, we're constantly nitrogen deficient. So we're responding with fertilizer applications when the turf begins to yellow. So many crops will give us signs that they're deficient in certain nutrients. All right, let's take a little quiz here. So we have kind of a match here. The ratio of sand, silt, and clay is it an A, chemical property, B, physical property, C, biological property, or D, rental property? Okay, so that's texture, and the ratio of sand, silt, and clay, texture is a physical property. The nutrients available, chemical, physical, biological. So nutrients are chemical properties, good. Earthworms, biological property, and the acidity of the soil would be a chemical property. And compacted soil. Is that physical, chemical, or biological? Compacted soil is associated with the structure and the pore spaces, which is a physical property.